Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and it is my good luck today to have as my guest the great violinist Erick Friedman, who has come to the halls of WNCN to talk about violin, boxing, world affairs, Wieniawski, Bartok, and Saint-Saëns, the three composers we're going to hear. Erick, how are you doing?
Wonderful.
Now, Erick is a friend of mine, and I must say that he's, of course, a great violinist, but he is a great fan of so many things. And the last time we talked, he was going to the fights, as they used to call them. Do they still say to the fights?
To the fights, I guess, yeah. You would say that.
Where you were going to hear the heavyweight championship.
As it turned out, hear it also.
Yeah. And we talked about, you know, boxing of the past, of which, you know, I love the statistics and the I said, who do you know who the first heavyweight champion of the world was and so forth? And he zoomed over and got his atlas and he read to me everything about it. Now, what? Because you said to me something interesting. There is an analogy between boxing and violin. Never have I put the two together. Tell me, Erick.
Well, I think there's a great analogy between them. And I have to say at the outset, I love to polemicize about things I know nothing about.
Mm-hmm. So do I, by the way.
That's why we're friends. And the element of boxing that is so congruent to violin playing are the elements that go into them. Guts, speed, training, guidance. Mm-hmm. I think the great attraction that I have, personally, and I've always been a tremendous fight fan, is due to the fact that if a manager or a trainer is not competent and he takes a fighter under his wing, he'll get knocked out of the picture maybe in 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
If an entrepreneur or an impresario or an agent or whatever takes a young performer under his wing, he might get knocked out of the picture in 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
So the career in a microcosm.
Yeah. Now, you said guidance, coaching, so forth. Certainly, the violin, James Honecker said, has the most delicate nervous system of any instrument. So the prize fighter also's body is one of the most delicate nervous systems. But what about the coaching aspect? How does a young child prodigy, in your case, and many people that play music are prodigious, how do you come or your parents come to know that you have to have very quickly in your life, or your options will be through very quickly of being a great violinist, a great teacher?
Well, I have to hasten to add, David, I don't want you to give the wrong impression. I'm not that young, you know, that I'm the world's oldest child prodigy, as some people have called me.
But you're a heavyweight champion in the violin world.
Well, I play. And, well, I feel this way, that the element of teaching, I think just as in boxing, since boxing and music are considered leisures and not necessities,
mm-hmm.
the element, the dichotomy between teachers and doers is enormous. There are many trainers,
mm-hmm.
as well as there are many teachers, who really have no experience whatsoever on the stage.
Yes.
And they don't know the aspects of a career. They don't know what goes into bringing a career to fruition so that it doesn't create neuroses.
Yeah.
They don't understand that there's the manifold process of learning to play well in public, and learning to play well over a period of years.
Mm-hmm.
This is what a fighter has to learn, on how to sustain a career for a number of years, how to box, and how to box well, and how to box so that he retains his stamina and he retains his career, he retains his senses, he doesn't get hit too much.
Mm-hmm.
There's my whole family's in medicine, and there is a terrible trauma to the brain. Every blow, the smallest blow, there is hematoma.
Really?
Oh, yes.
Now, how
well,
do you
I don't want to get into boxing, but
how do you equate this to violin playing, though, since we started with this analogy?
If a young performer is not guided properly, and doesn't know how to prepare for the stage, and then gets into that catathemic crisis arena. It's a fancy word. I wish I knew what it meant. Of having to perform and having to be judged not only by one's peers but one's older peers, and being made a fool of oneself, even to oneself, doesn't necessarily have to be to the public.
Yes.
That trauma is so great that it's very difficult to surmount it.
Mm-hmm.
And the little teaching that I do, I often say to some students, I wish I had a spray that I could buy in a hardware store where I could just spray them and they would unlearn what they've learned, and it would take me less time to guide them than it would having to unguide what they've been what they've already been taught.
Now, as a teacher, do you find it advantageous that you yourself have a stage career at all times?
Absolutely. That kind of experience is invaluable. But I can I could quite honestly say without sounding a little bit nasty that in the pedagogical world, this means nothing.
You mean many people will teach without having that stage experience?
Yes. Uh-huh. And the fact of a performer having experience of somebody like myself who has recorded over the years and performed and played all around the world, having to travel and having to live under all kinds of conditions and having to sleep in airports and having to rehearse and sometimes not rehearse and having to play with all kinds of orchestras of competency and conductors of varying degrees of competency. This kind of experience is enormous, but I can tell you without equivocation that in the performing arena of the music schools in this country, it means very little because it's more predicated on reliability of lessons and being able to attract the talented students. Mm-hmm. And I think that this is, you see, the element of music school, since it is a leisure, and one always has to differentiate. There's that separation between church and state. There's a separation between the necessities of the professional world, which would be medicine, law, architecture, things that the civilization must have to survive in the most efficacious way. As opposed to the arts, painting, music. These are things that are not considered seriously.
They're intangible as well, and they're still considered often a cosmetic, even in the university.
That's right. Yeah. I mean, nobody, for example, nobody would go to a medical school, and you would never expect a medical student to decide who is going to be on the faculty.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's up to the administration, hopefully, themselves having a certain degree of experience on competency of the teaching level, of the professional level. It's not the students that decide it, but in a musical institution, it is the students that decide who will join the faculty. Simply by who might have the nicest manner, who might have the greatest communication.
Or reputation. Yeah. There is one thing in common, though, of medicine and the art of music as it's practiced. And it seems that all doctors get to practice just like musicians.
That's right.
And that has always, of course, frightened me because I know when I practice how bad it is.
Believe me, doctors practice too in that pejorative way.
Yeah. Now, we're going to hear three works from your discography, Erick Friedman, and we're going to begin hearing the introduction and Rondo Capriccioso by Camille Saint-Saëns. And I don't think really there is 9 minutes of music that has more, I would say, impact for the audience in a concert than this wonderful work, which I think stems from Mendelssohn into the French tradition, into Saint-Saëns' very, very being. He was such a craftsman. Is it violinistic music?
I think the way there's a certain section that's marked morbidezza, which I think means with a certain kind of joy of living. It's strange to have that root morbid in it that typifies this particular work, and it has everything in it.
It's a wonderful work. We're going to hear Erick Friedman now, Chicago Symphony Orchestra, and who's conducting it, Walter Händel?
I think Walter Händel on that one, yes.
Here we go. Ah, you have just heard a dashing performance of the Saint-Saëns Rondo Capriccioso. My guest, the violinist, Erick Friedman, Chicago Symphony under Walter Händel. And we will return after these messages in a minute. This is David Dubal, and today I'm privileged to have as my guest the violinist, Erick Friedman. Erick, you're an American violinist, born here, right?
Right.
New York City?
Well, close enough.
Now, we were talking before while the Saint-Saëns was on. You said we were discussing fighting earlier, boxing, and you said you can't win. Earlier in your career, in a way, that had hurt you because some PR person took you to a gym and posed you, and there was a story in the Daily News or something like that, and for a while, nobody took you seriously.
Exactly.
You were the boxer violinist.
That's right.
Now, that goes to another item. You also said, in a certain way, you're not in style now. Explain that.
Well, I think that in any profession, and especially in a music profession, that is so transitory and modish, that just with pianists and voice, certain types of voices, certain types of pianists come to the fore. There was an era of Hoffman, then there was the era of Horowitz, and then the era very different pianists.
Yes, Hoffman would not be liked right now.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I feel that there's a certain similarity, a certain congruency in this area, too. We live in an age where TV has become extremely effective in terms of promoting music, mm-hmm. in terms of promoting the arts, and in terms of making artists recognizable. There's a certain element, it's almost like hubris, there's the moderation in Greek, that there's a certain element of emotion necessary from the performer that is detract from the music. And from a musical point of view, because the kind of concentration that goes into playing is enormous. Mm-hmm. And if music making, especially for violence, becomes emotive on one's face or one's body English and bodily movements, it has a tendency to be very effective in the broad palate. Mm-hmm. But there is some diminution, as it were, of the kind of artistic thought that goes into each particular measure. And it's very much a part of, there's a lot more planning and musical soul searching that goes on in a performance than most people realize. Mm-hmm. It's not something that just comes out. Mm-hmm. And I think we live in an age where it's more effective because since music has become an arena to attract the most possible people in terms of an audience, there is no longer a particular audience. Now there's a shotgun. Everybody has to know an artist mm-hmm. in order to become saleable. Mm-hmm. Well, this wasn't true in the past. And to a great extent, for example, in the career of Hoffman or Heifetz or even Kreisler, aside from a certain kind of genial spirit that Kreisler had as a person, the average person didn't see Kreisler's face. He walked out on the stage, didn't see Heifetz's face. They saw him more or less stand motionless and very, very, very contained, very controlled, very concentrated. But there was no expression on his face because it wasn't necessary. Like, it's not necessary to paint expression on a small figure in a painting. But as soon as the face became very recognizable, then it became necessary to be a certain kind of player.
Hmm.
And I always like to differentiate between there's a certain type of player, whether it be voice, violin, or piano, that can be very personally expressive. And there's another type of player that can be very musically expressive. And I'm only speaking from an auditor's point of view. There are many artists who I find very effective as people, mm-hmm. but not terribly effective as musicians. Mm-hmm. And then other artists that are very effective as musicians, but not terribly effective as people, mm-hmm. and are not saleable. And I think this has to do with a certain kind of modishness of the field now.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're not saying you're not saleable, because you certainly, as you just said, well, you just had a violin sonata written for you, and you're off to Paris to play that. You're playing constantly.
No, I'm thank God, you know, I'm very, very active and very busy.
Yeah.
I'm leaving myself out of this. I'm talking about, and there's a certain type of musical promotion that's going on. It's become a very, very big business.
Yeah.
Music, and I think that's something I like to say that because for the benefit of any young players and musicians who have aspirations for a career, I think it's very necessary for them to realize this and not to go into it with their eyes closed.
Is there much room now for a big career?
Even
if you have the abilities.
There's always room for a big career.
Uh-huh.
There's just not room for a very sustained career.
Sustaining is the big problem.
Yes, mm-hmm. that's the big problem. It's almost everybody of talent gets an opportunity. The sustaining of a career is very difficult. That so many things go into that. And unfortunately, very little has to do with the actual value as an artist. There's some wonderful players who simply do not sustain a career because of a certain kind of Well, there's some things today that muddy the waters to a great extent mm-hmm. in terms of ability. There are a lot of players, and I'm not just speaking about violinists, but pianists and some great singers too, who are not heard simply because they're not involved in the leverage game with managers.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's another talent. So if you don't have that ability, you're going to be in trouble to sustain the career, obviously. We spoke of two great violinists. You just did, Heifetz and Kreisler. And I'd love to speak about Heifetz because he was your teacher. But I also want to say that didn't you just, because I read an ad recently in the Musical Heritage magazine, just come out with something to do with Kreisler's music?
Yes, I just made a video cassette for a video cassette recorder. I guess this is...
That's the new thing, isn't it?
That's right.
Uh-huh.
And it's on VHS and also Betamax. So, and there are 11 Kreisler pieces.
Now tell me, what are the Kreisler pieces in your life as a violinist? Do you play them as encores?
Well, I say today, yes, they're mostly encore pieces. It's the seriousness of purpose and programming now is far advanced than what it was.
Is that good or bad? I mean, there seems to be
both.
So many heavy programs and no salad or dessert.
Both. I think what has happened is that it's become a diet, and diets are not terribly delicious.
Now, are you a sonata recital advocate,
no.
Or do you like to do it variously?
I like to have my appetizer, my main dish.
What would your main dish be? A viotti or something like that? Or
no, a main dish would be a...
The appetizer.
The appetizer. It might be a Handel or a Vivaldi mm-hmm. sonata. Mm-hmm. Or
9 minutes or something like
that's
that.
That's right, more or less.
And then a big Beethoven sonata?
A big Beethoven or a big... it doesn't have to be Beethoven. It could be any particular period, a Strauss or a Spighi or whatever. And then what might be the salad, what might be something like Rondo Capriccioso, like the piece we just heard, or Legend, or something of that ilk.
Yeah. Now, do you ever get exasperated with the literature, saying, oh, I wish it were bigger, or I wish it were smaller, or something? Do you feel that there's enough violin music to last your lifetime of practicing?
Well... that's kind of a moot question now, because to a great extent the recital field has died. There are not many sonata recitals anymore. I mean, solo recitals. There are sonata recitals, but usually for duos.
The career then is based on the orchestral appearance and records. Is
exactly,
that
records and orchestral appearances are the thing today, and TV appearances.
Yeah, and TV appearances what on the public or the Johnny Carson show, let's say, of which.
Well, I've been on a number of times on the Johnny Carson show, and I can say it had very little to do with my career one way or the other. Mm-hmm. It's a very nice vehicle. It makes one, to a certain extent, recognized. Mm-hmm. But it is really not the proper vehicle for a performing artist, because the kind of concentration necessary from a performance point of view is not there on television. To a great extent, television suffers from that. It doesn't have the captive audience. You have to win the public in serious music. In other types of entertainment, you've already got them.
Now, is serious music doing well in this country, in your opinion? Even though there are big careers and famous names still, of course. But is it doing...
I think it's become very ingrown. Mm-hmm. I think it's become extremely directed by something I mentioned before, managerial leverage, mm-hmm. and by certain special interests.
Well, that's not good for the art.
It certainly isn't.
Now, why is the solo appearance dying out in all fields? Certainly there's a lot of chamber music, but that solo recital is going.
I think it has to do with the fact that the psychology, this is just off the top of my head, psychology of career promotion has taken on the psychology of Madison Avenue, which has to do with new.
New.
The problem with new is that what is not generally recognized also is that Paganini started his career after the age of 40. Mm-hmm. So did Rubinstein. Mm-hmm. Most of the great performers had really their recognition at a rather late stage, and meaning that they had a certain degree of maturity and fruition in terms
today of... you have to win a competition and be and great at 22 and at 23 retire and become a legend in their own minds. Now, we're going to talk right now for a second about certainly one of the great violinists who kept developing in his career. His name was Henri Wieniawski. And he wrote a legend for, I think, this legend has some story to it of a woman, an English woman he was in love with or whatever. Now, what is this violinist in your career?
Wieniawski?
Yeah, violin
composer. Wieniawski has a very weird kind of attraction for me because Wieniawski was the first violinist to vibrate, to use the vibrato as a vehicle for the virtuoso style. Up to that time, violins did vibrate, but in a very small way and just a kind of a small tremor. But
so Paganini then did not probably have
didn't have any vibrato.
Really? How interesting.
Now, Wieniawski, the reason that Wieniawski began to vibrate was simply because he was the first superstar amongst violinists. That, of course, there was Paganini, but Paganini was had a very limited career in the places that he appeared because of the era that he lived. But Wieniawski was the first violinist to be the violinist of the Tsar, and he played and even came to this country. You know, he was an extremely prolific performer. And he played in larger and larger places. And the vibrato was a vehicle whereby a violinist could artificially increase the size of his sound without losing intonation or quality.
Well, we're going to hear, that's so interesting, we're going to hear the legend, his most famous work outside perhaps of the Second Concerto, with you playing the violin with Sargent and the London Symphony. And for 7 minutes and 28 seconds, we're going to hear very romantic music, aren't we, Eric?
Hopefully.
Okay, here we are. You have just heard the impassioned performance by Erick Friedman of Wieniawski's romantic legend, the London Symphony, Sir Malcolm Sargent conducting. And after these messages, I will be back with more talk and more music by my guest, Erick Friedman. Erick Friedman is my guest today. Erick, tell me, were you born to play the violin, so to speak? Was that the instrument that you believe you were predestined for musically, not the piano or conducting?
I really don't think so. I think the element of that what we do in life is usually predicated on what inspires us at a very young age. I happened to hear some recordings of various violinists as a youngster, and that was it. I wanted to do that.
What violinists?
Chrysler and Heifetz, I think.
Chrysler and Heifetz. So it's interesting how we stick with these loves, so to speak, because we were just speaking of Heifetz, who you studied with, and I'd love to talk about him in a second, but you have just completed this audiovisual, is it called cassette?
Video cassette.
Video cassette for Musical Heritage, where you're playing 11 Chrysler works and talking also about Chrysler. Be very interesting. I can't wait to see that. When did you get to study? Quite a privilege, I would say. Quite an interesting thing, am I right?
Yes.
You studied with Heifetz?
Yes.
Heifetz is, well, we were even saying something and laughing in a way because an image forms around an artist, and I said to you, well, the history books will always say the greatest violinist of the 20th century or something like that is Jascha Heifetz, but he was always heartless. And you said, indeed, he has suffered from that. Would you talk about that a bit?
The only thing heartless about that is the comment itself.
Yeah. But,
you know, that, in fact, it's been just the opposite. I think that that when we get our ages, you know, that we learn that the kind of inviolate rule of opposites, the law of opposites, things are usually the opposite of what they appear.
That's right.
And I think this has pretty much happened to Heifetz himself. He was a violinist who had such a command of the instrument, but more importantly, he used that command to create one of the most unique artistic pictures in history. But he had a certain style of playing, which was he came from a certain era, and I have a feeling that what happened. I mean, a very good pianist friend of mine said to me once that in the era of Heifetz, when Heifetz was very active, if somebody could not criticize Heifetz this way, not say this about him, what would have happened is that all the other violinists would have had to put their violins in their cases and not played until he disappeared from the scene.
Yes, how interesting. What was that famous remark that Gudovsky made with Misha Elman in the audience at the debut, Heifetz's debut.
Yes.
You know that?
Yes, that's Hot for Violence, you know. But, of course, that's a well-known story. Incidentally, Elman was also a violinist I very much admired.
Yeah. What was it, the sound?
Well, Elman had a very different way of playing as he got older. I think, as many violinists did, he began to develop his own style that would be just the antithesis to Heifetz. Because as a violinist, in his young years, Elman was absolutely the equal of Heifetz in terms of his ability on the instrument and also his ability with sound, which he had even more of a... But what happened with Elman was that he became very mannered. He started to play a certain way that was very moving to some people and a great turnoff to others. Mm-hmm. That happened with Heifetz, but to a lesser extent. Mm-hmm. But this is the meaning of being an artist. I think the reason I mention that is because I think it's a little bit unfair to the memory of Elman. He really didn't say that mm-hmm. exactly.
Apocryphal story, anyway.
But it came, became a... That's right. It
was well, I don't think we actually vocalized the story. Heifetz made his debut, and Gudovsky, the great pianist, went with Elman, and Elman said, gosh, it's hot in here. And Gudovsky said, not for pianists, Misha. Yeah.
That's right. That's right.
But in a sense, Heifetz's presence did... I'll use the word traumatize so many violinists either into virtually having inferiority complexes, quitting, or and in a way that's analogous to when Horowitz came and one pianist in the audience said, "Well, that's the end of our career."
That's right. That's
and right. These people are phenomenons, of course, and often when they have such gigantic mechanisms like a Heifetz or Horowitz, they start becoming dubbed as soulless or unfeeling, just virtuosos. So,
I can tie this into what we were talking about at the beginning of the program, that the element of performance. There have been many, many wonderful players, but the element of performance is something that the conquering of one's nervous system. And that has to do with not the conquering of one's nervous system. That has to do with training for the public stage.
Yes, absolutely.
And you can't. It's trying to contain one's nerves is like telling somebody to not think of the word elephant. That's mm-hmm. all they'll think of once you tell them that. But the element of preparing a youngster for the concert stage is delegated to the very few knowledgeable. And most people don't know it. And I could say without equivocation, at risk of stepping on a lot of toes, I don't think there's any teacher today who knows it mm-hmm. on how to try to do that.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting.
They know how to teach their kids to play well, especially if they're talented, mm-hmm. which almost, you almost have to hit them with a board to keep them from playing well. Mm-hmm. But they don't know the stage. They don't know the element of preparation for the stage.
Yeah, it's as different as the studio is from the earth to the moon. The stage has to have an experience level of its own at all times, and it can't just stop. You can't play once a year, even though you play wonderfully at home.
That's right.
And that's, of course, a great pity because many people have a chance to only play once a year.
That's right.
We're going to conclude the program, Erick, with the last movement of your Bartok concerto, if you don't mind.
With pleasure.
Great. Well, this is the Southwest German Orchestra, and who is the conductor?
Zenik Matzel.
Aha. And Erick Friedman is the soloist. Let's hear it.
Thank you.
We have just heard the finale of Bartok's violin concerto. Zdenek Matzel is the conductor of the Southwest German Orchestra, and the soloist, my guest today, Erick Friedman, in a murderously difficult concerto. Erick, we'll be right back after these words, and we'll have a final benediction from you.
Good.
This is David Dubal, and my guest today has been Erick Friedman. I have so enjoyed talking to you about the violin, and Paganini's birthday is coming up, and I would love to talk to you in November about that fellow. Quite a man in your life, right, even though you never met him.
No, I never had the pleasure.
Thanks for coming to visit me, Erick.
Thank you for having me.
And I wish you the best of luck always. This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.